So in leading off a series of presentations on potential triggers for mass extinctions, I'll be focusing on large igneous provinces, or LIPS, which have been widely implicated. Now, there's connectivity between the two, but understanding the relationship between these terrestrial igneous events and mass extinctions hasn't been so straightforward. Now, LIPS and below-level impacts are arguably the two most plausible drivers for mass extinction events on Earth, and both are in many ways sort of exceptional, episodic, and geologically rapid events that at their extremes can pose global environmental impacts. So what I'm going to do is start off focusing on LIPS and some of the key attributes or features of them that underpin why they may be an important trigger for mass extinction events. And there are a number of good reasons for why we think LIPS are the trigger. The temporal link between LIPS and mass extinction events appears robust and is being improved by a number of high-precision geochronology studies, which Blair Shearn will talk on a bit more later. Shown here is the widely used correlation diagram showing the timing of LIP events and a corresponding global environmental change. And it's only the end Ordovician extinction event that is currently uncorrelated with a known LIP event. On Earth, we have two general groups of LIPS, and certainly in terms of where they are in place, their crustal setting. Those are placed on the continents, for which we have, and most related to the breakup phase of the supercontinent cycle, for which we have a geologic record dating back to the Archean. We also have LIPS in place in the oceans or onto oceanic crust, for which our geologic record is much more restricted, and they're mostly Mesozoic in age. However, the oceanic plateaus are the largest LIPS we see on our planet's surface today. This is a LIP distribution map from a paper last year showing the distribution of LIPS in place since the assembly of Pangaea at about 320 million years ago. And we can see LIPS are globally distributed, occurring on the continents and in the oceans, and from the poles to the equator. Most of these LIPS have been placed or erupted at least 1 million or more cubic kilometres of magma at the Earth's surface. The largest LIP that we know of is the recombined and pre-rift Ontong Java, Manahiki and Hikurangi plateaus in the southwest Pacific that had original and estimated total igneous volume of at least 75 million cubic kilometres. This mega plateau covered at least 1% of the Earth's surface. And to put that into context, it was the size of the Indian subcontinent. And this subcontinental igneous mass was produced in about 30 million years or less. One of the features of LIPS is that they are rather unexpected or unheralded igneous events. And many LIPS occur in the interiors of tectonic plates, far removed from then active plate boundaries. And what we want to illustrate with this figure from our 2008 paper is the fact that many of the continental LIPS are in place into stable continental regions, characterized by long-lived histories, often lasting hundreds of millions of years, of no prior igneous activity or contractional deformation. Consequently, there were no telltale signs at the sites of these LIP events for this impending magmatic onslaught. Now, LIPS represent very vast and very rapid emplacements of large igneous volumes, and the rates of emplacement are orders of magnitude higher than we see at modern day plate boundaries. A feature too of LIP events is that much of the volume is in place in very short periods or pulses that may be 1 to 5 million years in duration and perhaps a little bit less. And this is well illustrated for the Columbia River flood basalt province, our youngest LIP, where a large proportion of erupted volume recorded by the Grand Ronde basalts, which is the main stratigraphic unit in this province, and representing about 72% of the known erupted volume, was in place in as little as 400,000 years, despite volcanic activity lasting from about 17 through to 6 million years ago. Now, something that's less appreciated and recognised is the fact that in addition to this tremendous erupted volume, there's an even more substantial intrusive volume. And this is this intrusive volume is stored as intrusions throughout the crustal profile and also as igneous underplate. We can see this intrusive volume very well for the oceanic plateaus, with a typical crustal thickness of oceanic crust, which is about 7 to 8 kilometres, balloons out to be up to 30 to 40 kilometres thick beneath these oceanic plateaus. It's estimated that the intrusive volume, or ratio of extruded to intruded magma, is about 1 to 10. And the implication here is that this intrusive volume can also add, through degassing, to the substantial volatile emissions to the atmosphere. Now, to build up this tremendous volume of magma in geologically brief periods requires that we have hundreds, if not more, very large super eruptions, each erupting hundreds to potentially 10,000 cubic kilometres of magma. Importantly, LIPS are the only known site on Earth for basaltic super eruptions, where we're erupting at least 360 cubic kilometres of magma per eruption. And for the continental LIPS, these basaltic super eruptions occur in tandem with silicic super eruptions. Many previous studies on the flood basalts and these basaltic eruptions have shown that they can just essentially be considered as enormous or giant pahoehoe lava fields, built up by eruptions that are really sustained for years to decades. In contrast, the silicic super eruptions are a class of eruptions that we really have not witnessed, certainly in terms of the extremes of the magma volume that can be erupted, and the discharge rate that can peak to 100 billion kilograms per second for eruptions that may last only a matter of days or weeks. Put in perspective, the well-studied historic Plinian eruptions have peak discharge rates of only 1 billion or 10 to the 9 kilograms per second. Some recent studies starting to come out are suggesting that these volcanic pulses for LIPS may in fact be quite hyperactive, in that we are emplacing these majority of the eruptive volume in periods of only a few hundred thousands of years. And this leads to averaged eruption rates of at least 1 to 2,000 cubic kilometres per thousand years. Now, lending some supporting evidence for this more intense and hyperactive character of the volcanic pulses is that we may actually have contemporaneous eruptions happening. This is something we touched on in our 2010 paper. So on the figure on the left from the Paraná flood basalt province in Brazil, in some of the sections through here, we see a high titanium and compositionally similar flood basaltic lavas labelled as units 9 and 10 were being split apart and interspersed or interbedded with a very distinct low titanium flood basaltic lava. And the implication being the conclusion that we had these two chemically distinct lavas being erupted from widely separated vents at the same time. Likewise, in the associated Atendeka province in Namibia, during the Gobba Boseb quartz latite eruptions, we had two chemically distinct basaltic lavas being erupted across the region at the time of these eruptions. In a recent study, one of our students in the Cambrian Kalkarindji flood basalt province in northern Australia, we found also for one of the MAP units, this unit E, which is a compound pahoehoe flow unit, that there were two chemically distinct magma types being erupted to construct this compound unit, each producing different lobes within this unit. Collectively, these examples demonstrate that we may actually have contemporaneous eruptions and super eruptions during these hyperactive volcanic pulses, the implication being that we may have much more enhanced volatile emissions going on to the atmosphere than not really accounting for in the models at present. In contrast, there are some other studies suggesting that, in fact, the majority of the volume is actually being placed over longer periods and these pulses are a bit more sluggish. And it may actually take several million years to emplace these large volumes, such that our average eruption rates are down to 200 or 100 or even less cubic kilometres per thousand years, an order of magnitude less. It's not the magma volume that's important, but the volatiles that have been dissolved in that magma volume that can be exsolved and emitted during eruptions or degassed from shallow intrusions. That's really critical to the debate about how LIPS might trigger mass extinctions. And the key volatiles we're concerned with are carbon dioxide, sulfur, which Anya will talk on a bit later, and a number of halogen species. While the data are still in its infancy, they are starting to indicate the tremendous tonnages of these aerosols that are being emitted during LIP events. And these aerosol budgets really dwarf our current budgets for these volatiles in our present-day atmosphere. So there's general consensus that the way LIPs trigger mass extinctions is through atmospheric modification and climate change. However, there's still a lot of debate as to which volatile-driven mechanism is most important, whether it's CO2-driven warming, sulfur-driven cooling, or atmospheric destruction and ozone destruction through sulfur and halogen emissions. I think an important observation to make and a question to ask is, why haven't our largest LIPs, which is the oceanic plateaus, why are they not linked to our largest mass extinctions? Given their tremendous igneous volume, they should have concomitant huge aerosol emissions, particularly CO2. And yes, while these oceanic plateaus in place in the oceans and their tremendous CO2 emissions drive increased ocean acidity, ocean anoxic events, and extinctions in the oceans, as well as transfer of the oceans and increased greenhouse conditions, the effects on land are much more muted. A key difference for these oceanic LIPs is that many of the eruptions are happening underwater in sort of 1,000 or more metres water depth, and they fundamentally lack the ability for those eruptions to inject these aerosols directly to the atmosphere. And so a key point of difference then is that, and what may be important for triggering mass extinctions, is delivery of aerosols directly to the atmosphere and to the stratosphere. One caveat in terms of our estimation of volatile budgets from LIP eruptions and events is that they are based on petrologic estimates where we try and estimate the amount of volatiles that can be dissolved in that magma composition of that volume. One of the things we've observed with recent eruptions, and certainly headlined by the Pinatubo eruption, is the fact that we can have much larger aerosol emissions that can be estimated or accounted for by the erupted magma volume. And this has led to the term the excess sulfur problem, where we had a separate magmatic volatile phase present in association with the magma, which also had dissolved volatiles in it. Now, given the tremendous underplate igneous volumes that we have during these LIP events, the high magma fluxes, it's very plausible that we may also have this sort of excess sulfur and other volatile contributions during the basaltic and silicic super eruptions, which we're really not going to be able to account for or estimate through our petrologic approaches. Certainly for sulfur and the halogens, delivery to the stratosphere is fairly important, particularly to maximise their residence time, their global dispersal, and ozone destruction. The problem we have is that the majority of the LIPs are built up by flood basalts, which in their eruptive style is essentially very effusive, although they were stained. They're very low vigour fountains, really unable to efficiently deliver these sort of aerosols to stratospheric heights. Now, a recent study this year by Richie Brown and others looking at the vent deposits to the Rosa flood basalt in the Columbia River described a number of pyroclastic cones developed and spaced fairly regularly along the vent fissure through part of the vent region to this lava field. Now, while these pyroclastic cones do record periods of more intense and vigorous lava fountaining, such that ash and aerosols may well be able to convectively rise to heights of 10 kilometres or more and touch the base of the stratosphere, the problem is that these pyroclastic deposits really only record brief, intense phases of fountaining that may only last a few hours at each vent site. And cumulatively, for an eruption that lasts at least a decade, it's only representing a few months of activity where we may have very high fluxes of sulfur and other volatiles to stratospheric heights. So we still have a real problem of trying to get these aerosols to high altitudes in our atmosphere. On a final point, recent studies by Ben Black and others for the Siberian traps are really starting to emphasise the significance of halogen and sulfur emissions to atmospheric destruction. These are two models showing the effects from one of the eruptions from the Siberian Traps, where we have very substantial ozone destruction, and despite the high latitude of eruptions, the effects on stratospheric ozone is global and particularly harsh at the high latitudes. The implication of these sorts of models and effects on ozone is that UV fluxes may actually increase to almost 5,000% at the surface. So these sorts of effects from sulfur and halogens are really quite insulting, using the previous speaker's terminology, and devastating on the environment and the ecosystems. So just to conclude, it's now appearing that some LIPS may have very hyperactive volcanic pulses, where the majority of the volume may actually be in place in a matter of a few hundred thousand years. And these LIPS are the ones at present correlated to the main mass extinction events. This allows or provides opportunity for more contemporaneous or coeval super eruptions, enhancing greater aerosol delivery to the atmosphere, as well as shorter recovery time between eruptions and for the environment to recover. And the kind of work that Ben Black and others are now showing for the Siberian Traps is suggesting that maybe these very rapid short-term fluctuations that may last for years to a decade after each eruption, particularly in pH through acid rain, temperature variations and these very extreme UV fluxes, may be more important in triggering the kind of effects that Doug just talked about previously in causing rapid extinction events, rather than sort of the long-term cumulative effects of CO2 or potentially sulfur-driven cooling. And so really, the atmosphere and the environment are becoming quite punch drunk from these sorts of repeated and devastating atmospheric effects. I'll conclude there. Thank you.
Okay, we have a microphone now, so if anyone has any questions, you put your hand up and we'll deliver you the thing.
Who has a question? Anyone?
Question?
You were talking about ultraviolet radiation and the ozone layers. I wondered, how long did you think it would take to recover?
I'm not an atmospheric scientist, but certainly Ben Black's model is saying that the effects last for 10 years. And again, it's a question of how quickly the eruptions or the hiatus between eruptions. If eruptions only, if we have coeval eruptions or the slightly staggered, then we can have sort of continual effects. But certainly, I think if there's hiatuses of 1,000 years or so, I think the implication is there's some general recovery. So the shorter we can have the repose periods between eruptions, the more likely the continual destruction and this UV impact can occur.
Okay.
Thank you.